Hi everyone, and thank you for joining the Microsoft Developers Channel. My name is Henk Bolm, and I'm a Cloud Advocate at Microsoft. And today I'm going to talk to you about how you can build and deploy PyTorch models with Azure Machine Learning. So let's go to the first slide. So what are we going to do? What is the agenda for this hour? First, we're going to see what is available on Azure if it concerns machine learning. We're going to have a brief look at what the data science process is, so we all understand what the data scientist has to do. And then we're going to build a Simpsons recognition model using Azure Machine Learning Service and PyTorch. But first, what is machine learning anyway? So machine learning is giving your computer the ability to learn without explicitly programming it. Meaning that in the old days, I wrote an algorithm, a lot of if-then-else statements, I run data through it, and I get answers. But now with machine learning, it is switched. I give it a bunch of answers, lots of data, I run it through the machine learning training program, and I will get the algorithm. In the machine learning world, that is called a model. And through that model, I can run new data, and I will get predictions on that data. So machine learning on Azure. What is out there and what is available? So the first layer is a top layer, and that are our sophisticated pre-trained models, meaning that are models developed by Microsoft exposed to APIs, and they are called cognitive services. So they do face recognition out of the box, object detection out of the box, speech services, language services, all by just calling an API. If you want to start doing it yourself, what we're going to do in this talk, is it supports all popular frameworks. So you can train PyTorch models on it, TensorFlow models, Keras models. It doesn't matter, you can train it on our cloud. There are also a lot of services to make it a little bit easier. So there is Azure Databricks, there's Azure Machine Learning, and there are machine learning virtual machines. So if you want to get started quickly with training your own models and you don't want to hassle set up your whole desktop, you can use one of those machine learning virtual machines that actually have all the elements and frameworks pre-installed for you. Of course, we have lots of infrastructure, CPUs and GPUs to actually train and run your model in production. And we can, of course, help it deploy it to on-premises, to the cloud, and even we can pick up your models and deploy it to the edge. So quickly, what are cognitive services? So cognitive services are our pre-trained models in the cloud. And some of them you can pick up and run on the edge. So we have vision, speech, language, and knowledge. So vision is there to make your application see what is around. Speech, to make your application listen and talk back. Language, to understand what is being spoken. And knowledge, if you want to tap into the knowledge of the internet. But yeah, we want to level up today. We don't want to use these great cognitive services, but we want to build one ourselves. So before we are going to do that, we first have to understand how the data science process works. So what needs to be done before you actually can train one of those models? And that is called the data science process. So every training, every model starts with a question. So you have to ask a sharp question. Then to answer that question, you need to collect data. If you have the data, you have to prepare it. When the data is ready to run through your algorithm, you have to select one algorithm, of course. Then you can start actually training the model, and then you can use the answer. So what is a sharp question? A sharp question, there are basically only five types of questions you can ask a machine learning model. That is like, how much or how many? Is it this or is it that? Is this weird? To which group does it belong to, and which action can I take? And we are going to answer a question for this example, what is the price of a second-hand car? So for that, we need data. And there are a lot of public data sets available. So you can go to the website Kaggle, where you can have like publicly available data sets and even do challenges on machine learning. You can go to UCI, the machine learning repository, and the Azure Machine Learning Service also has a lot of sample databases to get you started. So I found on the website Kaggle a dataset with used sales cars. So it looks like this. Like lots of columns, lots of prices, VIN numbers, makes, everything is there in one big CSV. So now it is there and I have it, I can start preparing to run it through my algorithm. So for every column in this dataset, you have to ask yourself a few questions. Is this column relevant to answer my question? Is this column independent enough? Is it simple enough to understand? And is my data clean? So we'll dive into a little bit more in these questions. So with relevant, I mean, is this relevant to answer my question? So yeah, the price is quite relevant to answer my question. That's actually the answer I want to have. But is the city, the state, and a VIN number really necessary to have in my first data set? No, so you can throw those out. Then are these columns independent enough? Like, are there not two columns telling me exactly the same thing? Like, the year is 2015 and the car is an age of 3 years. So yeah, throw one away. There are other means of boosting the importance of one of these columns. And is my data simple enough? In this data set, I had like all the sub models. Yeah, and I wanted to have like a little bit simpler model. A car make car model to start with. So I made them a little bit simpler. So I had less classes. And is my data clean? Meaning, is there no crap in my data set? Because if you have like wrong data in, you will get wrong predictions from your model. So you have to be very careful which data you put into your machine learning model. So now our data is clean. And then it is time to select an algorithm. And there are a lot of cheat sheets to actually come to a few algorithms that might work for your specific problem. So you can follow the arrows. We say start, I want to predict values, and then I can pick 5 algorithms. I don't have to pick exactly one and start experimenting with one. I can pick 5 and start experimenting with these 5 algorithms. So I have my 5 algorithms and now it is time that I can actually train my model. So this is the flow how a model can be trained. So you import some data, you pre-process your data, you split your data because you use like around 70 to 80% for the actual training, and the other 20 to 30% you use to test your model to see if it is actually performing and predicting the right values. So then we score the model at the test set, we see how good it is, and then we evaluate the model. So we can do this in our Azure Machine Learning Studio. There is a new version already available, but the interface looks quite the same. So here you see I have the same data, the same split of the data, and then I'm running 2 algorithms against each other. I score it against the same test set, and then I can evaluate which model performs the best on this data set. And then, very important, don't forget to use the answer. And you can do that in many different ways. You mostly get like a model file and you can run that everywhere. You can wrap it up in a Docker container and deploy it to every service that can run Docker containers. You can have it hosted as an API. You can actually use it in some Azure functions and you can deploy it to edge devices. It can even run on a Raspberry Pi. So now we know this, and I want to zoom in a little bit into Azure Machine Learning Studio. So what is Azure Machine Learning Studio? It is a managed cloud service. It is actually a lot of services combined that helps you build, create, and deploy your models. So it covers the whole data scientist process from end to end, from the training to the deployment to running in production. And we are going to answer the question on this fun data set. Is it Marge, or is it Homer, or is it Bart, or is it Lisa? And for that, we need a lot of data. And I managed to have like lots of Lego figures. I have children, so we have Lego figures. So I made a lot of pictures from these Lego figures. I made 50 from each class. And you can find this data set on my GitHub and can play with it yourself. So what are we going to use to answer this question and to create this machine learning model? So we're going to use Azure Machine Learning Service. We're going to use the PyTorch framework. We're going to use some GPUs in the cloud. And we're going to deploy this model to an endpoint in Azure Container Instances. So what we try to accomplish here is that we have a data scientist that is going to train and shape the model and delivers this model in a service called Model Management. We have a developer that's going to pick up this model, write software around it, and registers a container in Azure Container Registry. And then we have operations that is going to pick up that Azure container and is going to deploy it to an Azure Kubernetes service, to an Azure Container Instance, whatever your business requires. And then, of course, we have a final client that will actually call that service and can use the predictions. So you need to go to three phases if you're going to start with Azure Machine Learning Service. So first you have to prepare your environment. Then you can start experimenting with your data and your model. And then when you're very happy with your model, you can deploy it. So the first step is preparing your environment. You can do that in multiple ways. You can go to the Azure portal and say create new Azure Machine Learning Service environment. You can use Visual Studio Code with Azure Machine Learning tools installed. Or you can do it from a Jupyter Notebook. In Jupyter Notebook, you can use the Python SDK. And if it is in code, you can version it. So my preference is always do something in code and version what you have doing. So you create a repeatable process later on for your colleagues to repeat it actually and redo it. So you can do that in Azure Notebooks that are our hosted notebooks in the cloud. Or you can do it on your local machine like I do. So to create a workspace in Python, first you have to install the Azure ML Python SDK. And then you can start creating your workspace. So you say workspace create, give it a name, give it your subscription ID, give your resource group, and tell it where you want to host it. Then you write a config. And if you have written that config file, everyone else can load the workspace from that config file. So they can say workspace from config. And this is how it looks. So you can go to ml.azure.com. It's a separate portal with a very clean interface where you can monitor this wall, all your resources, all your experiments. So what do you get? Let's zoom into the left menu. So first of all, we have data sets. Here you can actually register your data. So I have a Simpsons dataset, and we are going to later on register that dataset in Azure Machine Learning Service as a dataset. Then we have experiments, and these ones keep track of our training runs. So every time we try something to train the model, everything is logged under an experiment. Then we have models. Here we can store our models. I always compare it to like a NuGet repository for models. So if your model is done, you push it to model management, you get a version, and everyone else can connect to that model management service and pull that model out. Then there are endpoints. There are two types of endpoints. The real-time endpoints, that is where our models live, our deployed models live, mostly in Azure Container Instances or in Azure Kubernetes services. And there are pipeline endpoints. And pipelines are training workflows that can be published so you can call them over and over again. Then we have some management things. So we have compute, that is where we can manage our training clusters, our inference clusters, everything is managed under there. And then there are data stores. And these are, here you manage the physical connection to the actual blob service or your database. So when you train something, you don't have to use credentials in your Jupyter notebooks. You can just refer to a data store. And if you're connected to Azure Machine Learning Service, yeah, it will take care of that connection for you. So the second thing we need is compute. So we have the workspace, so now we need compute. So with these two lines, I'm actually creating a whole Azure Machine Learning Service cluster. I say create a virtual machine, Azure Machine Learning Compute cluster with virtual machines standard NC6 that are the cheapest virtual machines that actually have a GPU in it. They're around $400 a month. And I specify how many nodes I want to have up and running. So when I say minimum nodes is one, I will always have like one node up and running, so I'm being billed for the whole time. But you can also say minimum nodes is zero, and then it will automatically shut down if you're not training. And of course it will automatically spin up when you want to do something. But then you have like a slight delay. It takes around 5 minutes for your cluster to be operational. And you can set the maximum number of nodes. So if you're running concurrent jobs, you can scale out to a maximum of 6 nodes. So now we have a workspace, compute, and we need to have access to our data so we can attach storage. So by default, it comes with a default storage blob, with a default data store. And that is a default blob storage with a very long name. But you can also connect to every other blob container. It doesn't even have to be in your subscription because you just give in the account name and the account key. So let's have a look at some code on how it actually looks the workspace. So I have a Jupyter notebook, and we start with importing lots of dependencies. And here I'm actually connecting to my Azure Machine Learning workspace. So my workspace is called Cybertron. In the Cybertron resource group, I just give my subscription ID, and my compute target is called Optimus Prime. So the first time I have to do this, to workspace get, and then I can do workspace write config. So now the second time, or the third time, or the fourth time, I can just run the comment workspace from config. Then I create a compute target, connect to my default data store, and connect to my first experiment where we're going to zoom in a little bit later. And this is how it looks. So if we go to compute, we'll see that I have two training clusters here. Here's my Optimus Prime training cluster. And we see that it has one node up and running for us. Hopefully in a little while it will show us. Yes, here it is. And it is absolutely doing nothing at the moment. And here on the data stores, we should see my default data store. If I click on that, we will see that it points to an Azure Blob container and using an account key to connect to that. So let's go back to the presentation. So now we are ready to actually start training our model. We have a workspace, we have compute to do it, and we have a place to store our data. So the second step is experimenting with our model and data. And this is actually the fun part. But before we can do that, we need to create an experiment. And under an experiment, we will find everything back what we are going to do for the model. So all of your colleagues can also go to that experiment and see what I have done and how I've done it. And for that, the second thing we need is an actual file that is going to do the training for us. So for this experiment, I actually have taken a file from PyTorch, from the PyTorch website, because I have little images. I only have 50 images per class. I need to do some transfer learning for computer vision. So I didn't know how that exactly worked. So I went to the PyTorch website and found this sample script. This sample script is available on GitHub. So I've just took this script, picked it locally, and put it in my Jupyter notebook. I made it a little bit smaller, but here it is. So we'll zoom into a little bit later what I've done with this script to make it actually run on Azure Machine Learning. So we have our training file straight from the PyTorch website. And now we have that, we actually have to define how that is going to work. So for that, you need an estimator. So here you see on this slide that I have a TensorFlow estimator, but there is also a PyTorch estimator, and they both work the same. It is just replacing a name, and Azure Machine Learning Service will pick another base image. So what is an estimator? An estimator is like the wrapper, the Docker container, where your training will actually take place in. So you have to give that a few parameters. So you say estimator is new estimator. So a PyTorch estimator in this case. We tell it where it can find the training script. We can parse some parameters to it, pass some parameters to it. We tell it on which compute cluster it has to run. So for us, that is going to be the compute cluster we have just created. And we tell it which script it has to execute when the container is actually up and running. We can specify if it has to use the GPU or not. And I think even the new version will automatically find out if it is being deployed to a compute cluster with GPU support. And then we can tell which extra packages need to be installed within that estimator. So for this estimator on the screen, I needed cyclic learned and OpenCV also to be available in that Docker container. And you can specify which framework you want to use. So when you have configured your estimator, you have to submit it to your cluster. So you are still connected to your experiment. So you submit that estimator within your experiment. So everything is locked in that experiment. And then you can ask the run details from it. And with that cool widget, the estimator is actually streaming back all the output to your Jupyter notebook. So you can real-time follow what is going on within your estimator. So let's build a one with PyTorch and see how that works. So first, we need to have data. And I told you I have these Lego figures in the on my GitHub. So you can just download this zip file. Then, so you download it, you extract it, and then you can upload that data to your data store. So I'm uploading it here to my default data store under in a folder called Simpsons Lego version 2. And here you see it is just uploading it. I will not do it because there are still a lot of files. So the second thing you can do, if you have your data on your data store, you can create a data set from those images. So here we will say these paths on this data store and create a file data set from it and register that data set in our Azure Machine Learning service. So here we do that and we can see that back. We can find that back under data sets. So here I register data sets and here we see my Lego data set. There is only one version available. So I can click on it and it will tell me how much files there are in, how big my data set is, which version, when it is created and when I last modified this data set. And here we can switch between the different versions. We can also consume it from here with some sample Python code. We can create a new version from it. And we can see which models are created from this data set. So now I have my data. We can do a small preview. And we see this is actually in my data set, like around 50 pictures from all the Simpsons. So now we have data. And now we can start actually training the model. So here is the PyTorch file. I compressed it a little bit, removed a lot of comments from it, and I added a few things. The first thing I added were some references. So I can send some parameters to this file, and I can connect actually to Azure Machine Learning Service while I'm running it. So I can grab the run current context, and I'll parse my variables. So what I'm doing here is I'm just parsing the location where it can actually find my data. And the rest is all the same as in the sample script you can find on the PyTorch website. So I've added one more thing. I've added some more logging to it. So here you can see, you can print everything to the console and it will be there in the log files. But if you run something to the, log something to the actual run context, it will log it also in a bigger context. So if I, for every training round, if I log the accuracy as an integer, as a number variable, it will automatically create a graph for me. So I can see over time my model improving or not improving, of course. And then the last thing you have to do, and you don't want to forget this, is actually save the model file in the outputs directory. So everything you save in the outputs directory is being copied over when your estimator is done. So when your estimator is done, it copies over all the log files and everything in the output folder back to your experiment, and it will shut down the Docker container where your estimator is actually running in. So if you don't copy it out, it's gone, and you have to redo it again. So don't forget to save it. And trust me, I've done that a lot of times. So you save it. So now we have our training script. It is just a Python file. We can create the actual estimator. So we point to the dataset, Simpsons dataset, and we mount it. So now it is available as a directory, as a virtual directory in the Docker container. Here we create an estimator. I will tell it where to find my training file. I'll parse in the script parameters, tell it on which compute target. There is an entry script. That is the training.py, that is that file. It will just execute it, tell it to use a GPU, install it, tell it to which extra packages it has to install. So you can use the pip package manager, or you can use it through the conda package manager, and it can tell it which version of PyTorch to use. So when I'm done with that, I can actually submit that estimator, and then I can ask for the details from it. So I've already run it, and this is what I mean with logging the accuracy through that run.log comment. It will log it all as floats, and it will create these cool graphs for me, which I can later on also find back under the experiment. I go to my Simpson PyTorch experiment, I will go to the latest run, I will go to metrics, and here I can actually check, like, show me the validation accuracy, validation loss, training accuracy. And here we see the graph. So everyone can come back here and look how the model was trained or what happened. So we can also go to the output logs, and here we can actually read the wall log. So that is where you can find everything back. So what actually happens when you submit that estimator to your experiment? So it snapshots the wall folder with all your training scripts. So you point to a folder, everything that is in that folder will be snapshotted and will be copied over to your experiment. It will create the estimator as a Docker container. So the first time it will build your estimator, that will take a long time. Long time, what is a long time? 5 to 10 minutes. And it will put it in your own Azure Container Registry. That comes default with if you install Azure Machine Learning Service. So it creates the Docker container. So the second time you submit that estimator, you don't have to recreate the Docker container. It will just use the same Docker container if you don't change anything on the configuration. So only tweak something in your Python file. Then, when it is done, it deploys that Docker container to your compute target. It is mounting the data stores. So in this stage, you can mount data sets and data stores. And it will launch the training script. And then it starts streaming the output through the experiment. And if you have your widget connected to it in your Jupyter Notebook, you can also get the output in your Jupyter Notebook. And then when it is done, it copies the output. So everything you save in the output folder in the Docker container, it will copy over to your experiment. So now we have trained, we have a deliverable. So now we have to actually register that model in model management. And that can be done by connecting to the run and you say register model. Give the name, tell it where to find the model, and it is registered and you will get a version from it. So now everyone can connect to that model management and pick out the model to use. So let's have a look how that works. So you can ask the status from the current run, you can connect to previous runs, and now we can actually register the model. So I'm giving my model a name, tell it where to find it in the outputs directory, and I can specify which framework was used to train it, which framework version. I can give a description, I can give some text to it, but I can also specify what the preferred restart configuration is for when I want to run this model. So I say, yeah, probably take like one GPU and at least 2 GB of memory. So I can specify that already here. And later on when I deploy it, I can point to that preferred resource configuration. So it's not a must. It is like an indication you can use. So and then we can register it. So here version 2 is registered. So we can go to Azure Machine Learning Service here. We can click on models. And here we see Simpson PyTorch. We can click on it. And we can actually see which artifacts are in that model, in which endpoints this model is, don't click on your model file, by the way, and in which endpoints this model is deployed. And we can actually start deploying it from here. So now step 2 is done. We've created an experiment, we created a training file, created an estimator. We submitted that estimator to the cluster. It gave us a model. And we have registered that model. So one thing we still want to see is if it actually works, I guess. So I've trained the model. So now we can also download that model from the model store. And we can run this model. So I've written a small piece of Python here that will actually load in the model, sends some test images to it, and will return us the prediction. So if we run this, we see that if I send datatest-homer.jpg to it, it will crop it, it will check if we have a GPU in it, and that runs the prediction against it, the data, and here it will show us the output. And the output is that it is like 92% sure that it is Homer Simpson on this image. So now the next thing what we want to do is deploy our model. Production, into dev, into test, doesn't matter, but we want to have it running somewhere that is not my PC. So for that we can use Azure Machine Learning Service to deploy it quickly for us. For that, we need a model, of course. We need a script that will actually load in the model and starts doing predictions against it. And we need to have a file that will tell us how the environment has to look. And we can combine these three. These three combined will create a Docker image for us. And that Docker image we can deploy. So how does a scoring file actually look? So we have to, of course, load Azure Machine Learning Service and then Azure Machine Learning Service SDK. And then we have an init function. And that function is called once. And in that function, you load your model. Because loading models takes a lot of time and you don't want to load in your model on every request. So one time you load in the model and then in the run method, you will start doing predictions against that model. Yeah, of course, you have to do some pre-processing over your image so it is the same shape as the data you've trained your model on, and then you can dump the predictions as a JSON. So this is how you can create a JSON API for it. You need an environment file, and that is basically where you specify which additional packages have to run in your environment to actually run your model. You combine these two in an inference config, tell the runtime is Python, which script it has to execute score.py, and which conda environment file you need. And then you can decide where you want to deploy that inference config to. So you can either choose to an Azure container instance. Let's just deploy it, it will create the instance, host the Docker container for you, you get your scoring URL. Or you can connect an Azure Kubernetes service to your Azure Machine Learning Service and it can deploy the model or the Docker container to this Azure Kubernetes service for you. Deploying to ACI can also be done from code. So you can say, deploy configuration, the CPUs, GPUs. This is the service you have to create. And then you can say model deploy, use this inference config, use this deployment config, and deploy it to this Azure container instance. Same for AKS, but before AKS, if you're doing AKS, you first have to connect to your Azure Kubernetes service. So let's deploy our model. So my scoring script is a bit longer because I need to do a little bit more. So this is how it looks. I will load in the model. I will load in the labels. I will get the input data, download the input image, do some pre-processing over it, check if there is a GPU in my available, and then I'll do predictions and I'll return the probability, the score, and the most accurate label for it. When I have my scoring file, I have to create the environment file. So I want to install the Azure ML defaults, PyTorch, TorchVision, and I need to have this specific version of Pillow. I write it out in an environment file, and then I create an inference config where I say, use this scoring file and this environment config. And then I can deploy it to Azure Container instances. So I give it a name, tell it which model it has. I will load in the model. So this is model version 2. And I say deploy. Azure Container Web Service, deploy this configuration. And here you see I reference to the CPU configuration that I specified at the model and also the memories in gigabytes. And I give it a description. This is a Lego classifier. I deploy this model. Now I have the configuration, I can deploy it. I tell it what the inference config is, what the deployment config is. I tell it that it is allowed to overwrite my model, so I can do multiple deployments to actually the same Azure Container instance. You don't want to do this in production because when you're deploying it, your Azure Container instance goes down for like 2 or 3 minutes, depending on how big your container is. So, but for dev test, it's perfect to reuse your container. Then you can connect. You can also connect to previous deployments and you can go for the scoring URI, which you can later on use in your applications. Same goes for the Azure Kubernetes service, but I just want to show you how to test this API. So I have a set of testing URLs with Simpson images, and we're going to run that against the Azure Container Service endpoint. So you can actually use Postman and start posting JSON to that endpoint, but you can also use the Azure Container Service run method. And there you can specify which JSON it takes in. So input data, JSON dumps, and I will tell it which image name it has to use. I do this in a loop, so we send like 6 images to it. I will run it, this cell, so we can see that the endpoints will actually work. Takes a little bit of time, but hopefully it will come back. So here we see that it is like 78% sure that this is Krusty, 62% sure this is Bart. You see there is a lot of other things around. Net, it's pretty sure. March, it's very sure, probably because of the blue hairdress. Lisa, it is somehow sure, and Homer, but at least it is correct, and with only 50 images and just a sample script from PyTorch. So can you imagine what you can do if you start actually tweaking this script and get more data? So, but you saw me deploying something from a Jupyter notebook. And we are on a developer's channel. And with all the DevOps movement, it is not the best to deploy models to production like this. So luckily, there are better ways and different ways to do this. So let's dive into that. So first, I want to introduce pipelines. So pipelines will help you create a repeatable process to actually deploy your models, to train your models, and help you deploy your models to the cloud. So when I talk about pipelines, there are multiple pipelines available. So we have Azure Machine Learning Service pipelines, and we have Azure pipelines. And they're two completely different things. So Azure Machine Learning pipelines are workflows of steps that can use data sources, data sets, and run on compute targets. You can kick them off unattended, they can run every night, and they are reusable. So you don't have to run this whole Jupyter notebook. You can just say kick off this Azure, this pipeline again. So they're good for tracking and versioning everything. While you have Azure pipelines that are part of Azure DevOps, they're good for orchestrating. They're good for continuous integration and they're good for continuous delivery. So we can use these Azure pipelines to orchestrate the whole process for us, because we can set up some extra gates and tasks. We can integrate it with even other services to do load tests on our production models. We can do whatever we want with it, and they can trigger on code changes. So imagine that you do a code change because your script is in GitHub. There is a code change. Your Azure DevOps goes off. Your pipeline goes off. It will check your code. It will actually start deploying and building your model. And you have everything there nicely managed and nicely versioned in Azure Pipelines. So let's zoom in to what a pipeline within Azure Machine Learning Service actually is. So it is a script that's run on a compute target in a Docker container. So basically the same as an estimator, but it is like a wrapper around the estimator. So it runs a script on a compute target in a Docker container. It can have input, so data comes in and data comes out. And it can take some additional parameters in it. And if we zoom out, then we can see how a whole pipeline can look. So we have a blob storage account with our data. We create a data set from it and we run a pipeline step that will prepare our data and version it again. And from that step, we get a process data step. Another pipeline step will actually train the model on that pre-processed data set and will deliver us a model. We can pick up that model and register that model in Azure Machine Learning and our model management. So later on, an Azure deployment pipeline can pick that up and deploy that for us. So let's have a look at the Jupyter Notebook where we're actually going to create one of these pipelines. So it is the same training script as what we used in the other, the same data set. So we start with importing dependencies, connecting to our environment, it starts with creating the pipeline. So a pipeline also can take parameters as input. So I specify here that the data set that goes into this pipeline is variable. I will tell it where it can find my training script. I will tell it which model it actually has to deliver. And I tell it under which experiment it has to log the output of this pipeline. So step one is data preparation. So I say create a Python script step. So this is the simplest script step there is. It is a basic container running Python. I tell it which script it has to execute, prep.py, tell it on which cluster it has to run, and I will give it the source dataset parameter as input, and I will tell it where to deliver the data. And I will tell it where the script folder is. So we can have a quick look at those steps. So this is a prep.step. I import some packages. There's a main method here, parsing all the input parameters. And then the only thing I do is make a directory on the destination and copy over all the data, because this is just an example of what you can do with it. We go back here and then we can actually create the train the model step. So here we see that I create almost exactly the same PyTorch estimator, and I wrap that PyTorch estimator in an Azure, in an estimator step. So I'll just point to this training estimator. I have an input and an output, and I will parse some additional parameters to it. And then the final step is the step that will register our model in model management. I create a pipeline. I say pipeline in this workspace consists of these steps. Validate it, please. So it will already check if it is not, if there are no mistakes in it anyway. And then I will publish this pipeline. And this pipeline is published on the Simpsons PyTorch pipeline training pipeline from an Azure notebook. And then I can submit this pipeline. So we have already seen this kind of widget, but here we see actually the individual steps, and we can click on one of those steps, and then we can get the output from that step and zoom into the individual logs for every step. So we can go to the training estimator, and here you also see the graphs that were created by running the run.log command. Here we see a nice drawing, but we can also see that if we go to experiments, to a pipeline from notebook, and click on it, we see that there is one run, and here we also see the graph of how the model is trained. We can see what data goes in, what data goes out, if they run successfully. We can click here, see actually where it got the data from, and we can click on it and we'll look at actually the outputs. So everything again from this pipeline is versioned under your experiment, so you can see all the log files later. So I want to talk a little bit now about continuous integration. And I want to show you how to set up the pipeline for Azure Machine Learning Service within Azure DevOps. So now we have seen how we can create a pipeline from Azure Notebooks. So now we're going to see how we can actually do it using Azure DevOps. So the first thing I did is everything that was in this Jupyter notebook, I've copied to setup pipeline.py. And I've added like a few more things so that there are a few more arguments possible, but it is the same code as that you saw in the Jupyter notebook. So we scroll through it here. So now we can go to Azure DevOps and we can create a pipeline. So the new thing is to create these pipelines in YAML files, so it is easier to read them here in Visual Studio Code. So I say here, when I do a commit on the master, you trigger a pipeline that is going to run on this build image, Ubuntu version latest. This build has a name, it's version 1.build ID. And then I start defining my steps. I first have to tell it which Python version it has to run. So I still do everything in Python 3.6. So I tell it to run Python 3.6. The second thing I tell it to do is to install the Azure ML SDK using the CLI extensions, including the CLI extension. So now I give my build agent the ability to use the Azure CLI to log in to my Azure Machine Learning Service. And then I say, use an Azure CLI step and run my setup pipeline.py in my subscription. So we can go to Azure DevOps and we can actually see that I did a last commit, cleaning everything up just for you. To clean it up, we can click on the job. And here we see what I did. It checked out the repository, set the Python version, it installed the SDK, it ran the command, so, and it kicked off the pipeline. So running the pipeline can take like hours, for instance. So what this script does, it just submits the pipeline, and then Azure Machine Learning Service takes over and starts running the pipeline, while this build agent shuts down. So it doesn't cost you like 3 hours of your build time, or of your build time within Azure DevOps. It is just, here you see, it takes like less than a minute, like 1:25 to run this whole pipeline. So that is actually taken off your build minutes and not the whole training process. So then when that happens, you go over to Azure Machine Learning Service, this experiment kicks off and something gets delivered to the Azure Model Management. And that is where your release pipeline will kick in. So the model arrives in model management, and that can actually trigger that a pipeline or a release pipeline is kicked off. So if we have a look here, or here we click edit, we can see it artifacts that you can actually select a specific model from an Azure Machine Learning Service endpoint. So you can connect to an Azure Machine Learning Service endpoint, specify which model it has to listen to, and then you create a source alias from it. So when it kicks off, it will just kick off this deployment plan. So it will first use the Azure CLI to retrieve some additional parameters and additional information for that model, like the inference config and so on, which is wrapped up and packaged with the model. And then it will use the Azure ML model deploy pipeline step that comes out of the box with the Azure DevOps extension, where you can just point to an inference config, to a deployment config, and tell it where to actually deploy this model for you. So this model is up and running. So what I want to show you now is still what I didn't show you yet, what makes this tool so powerful. If I go back to an experiment, like the first experiment, the Simpsons PyTorch experiment, I can click on this run. I can go back and see which data set was used when I was training the model. I can see which model it has delivered. So I can click on that version of the model. I can see which artifacts it has delivered, but I can also see where this model is actually currently deployed. So I can click on that and I will find the scoring URI here. I can see in which GitHub repository it lives, which configuration it has been using, and you can give it additional tags and more descriptions from it. So you can really trace the whole pipeline. So where it comes from and where it is actually running. So the complete pipeline, we have data preparation first, we have training and model registration that is wrapped up within this Azure Machine Learning Service pipeline. And then we have a DevOps release pipeline that triggers when the new model is registered and deploys that to an Azure container instance. But this is like any other deployment plan. Of course, you can push it if the model performs well. If you have done your A/B testing, you can deploy it to another container host, like Azure Kubernetes Service, and start running it in production. So I want to thank you for listening, and I will switch to the and I will switch to the chat to see if there are any questions I need to answer, or that Amy has already answered all the questions for me in the chat. So I will go here and I will switch back to my camera. So I hope you enjoyed it, and let's see. If there are any questions I have to answer, can you post them in our channel, Amy? Amy is saying that she answers most of them. So then I want to thank you for listening. All this code is available in the GitHub repositories that I can actually put into the chat, but I guess Amy has already done it. So this is the PyTorch example. We can go to GitHub, where we can actually where all the two examples is. So this is where Azure Machine Learning PyTorch demo is. And there is one where the whole thing with the pipelines is. So you can try that out. And I will, yes, where can we find the slides? I will post them on my speaker deck website. Let me find the URL for that. So I will upload them within, I still say, let's 10 minutes. So you can find the slides in there. Oh, how much does this cost? Is another question. So I'm running an NC6 machine, which is like 400 euros a month, but it takes me like 3 minutes to train. So the machine is actually up and running for 10 minutes. So that will cost me like less than 2 euros, or less than a euro, or less than a dollar for any training round. So within your $200 of free Azure credits, it should work. And you don't need an NC6 machine. You can also run this on a cheaper machine like the D series. It just takes a little bit longer, but if you're not in a hurry, then you can also run it on there. But deploying it for an Azure container instances, I think they're around $40 to $50 a month. What are the costs for using the Azure Machine Learning Service itself? I actually think that Azure Machine Learning Service itself is not charged, it is only the GPUs you use. And especially everything I showed you, you can do with the free version. Cool. So thank you. If you have any more questions, I'm always happy to answer everything on the channel you want. The most common channel to contact me and the most easiest is using Twitter. So I will share my Twitter URL here. So feel free to send me a message or try to find me on LinkedIn. Thank you. And have a great evening, morning, afternoon.